Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. For today's session, it'll be myself, and I'll be talking on facial nerve and facial palsy. The reason why we selected this topic was that most of the DNB students and the fellows were wanting to have this discussed. So I thought we'll have a discussion on facial nerve and the facial palsy. So before we go on to the understanding of the facial nerve, it's very important to understand the anatomy and how the nerve starts from the brain and comes to the target. Just a moment. Just a minute, please. Sorry, I hope it's all clear now. A small technical problem. Coming on to the anatomy of the facial nerve. The supranuclear neurons, which are destined to supply the facial nerve nucleus, are located in the precentral gyrus of the frontal lobe, the cerebral cortex. And as those fibers descend down to the corticobulbar tracts, they lie in the middle of the internal capsule. And as they descend downwards, they decussate just below the midbrain to cross over to the opposite side of the pons to supply most of the opposite side facial nerve. But at the same time, some of the fibers also supply the ipsilateral facial nucleus. Now, that is the reason why when you have a supranuclear lesion, the upper part of the face is actually spared, because the upper part of the face receives the nerve supply from both ipsilateral as well as the contralateral supranuclear neurons. Whereas when you have a paralysis of the nuclear or the infranuclear portion of the nerves, the entire face, hemiface, is involved. Now, coming to the nerve complex itself, the major bulk of the nerve complex is formed by the motor nucleus. Of course, the facial nerve nucleus has four subgroups. You have the motor nucleus of the facial nerve, the superior salivatory and the lacrimatory nucleus, the nucleus tractus solitarius, and the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve. They all emerge together. But the most important nerve of the motor nucleus is the motor component. Now, the most of the fibers which originate from the motor nucleus, they go dorsally. The motor nucleus is actually located at the lateral mid pons, and the fibers, they arcuate around the abducens nucleus, and then it comes ventrally and emerges out from the pons at the level of this cerebellopontine angle, along with the eighth nerve. And this is the point at which the nerve is actually circling around the abducens nucleus, is called the facial colliculus. Now, the parasympathetic component of the facial nerve lies just above the motor nucleus, superior to it. And these fibers, they actually, they do not swing around the abducens nucleus, but they emerge out along the nervous intermedius. And the parasympathetic supply, that the supply from the facial nerve is to the submandibular glands, the sublingual glands, and the lacrimal gland. Now, what is important the applied anatomy is that at the ventrolateral angle, this is known as the CP angle or the cerebellopontine angle, the facial nerve emerges out along with the eighth nerve, both the nerve roots. Now, between the two nerve roots lies the nervous intermedius. Now, we can have the nerve supply of this part of the pons is by the anteroinferior cerebellar artery. Now, this loops across the both the facial nerve as well as the eighth nerve. If there is any aneurysm involving the anteroinferior cerebellar artery, or if this artery is in very close contact to the nerve itself, a pulsation of the artery is hence transmitted onto the facial nerve, and this gives rise to a hemifacial spasm. Now, as the nerve emerges out, it enters into the internal auditory meatus, just close to the eighth nerve. In the tympanic bone, this is known as the intracanalicular nerve. It has three segments: the labyrinthine segment, which is the first segment. Now, the labyrinthine segment has important structures such as the geniculate ganglion. And from there, you have a branch, which is the greater superficial petrosal nerve, which ultimately supplies the lacrimal gland. Then there is a horizontal segment, which is called as the tympanic segment. Now, the tympanic segment lies just above the thin bone. So whenever the surgery is being done in the middle ear, it's very simple, imperative that they take care. Otherwise, they can injure the tympanic portion of the nerve. And then the nerve turns at a right angle downwards, and this is known as the mastoid segment. The mastoid segment gives two very important branches. So the first is the nerve to stapedius, or the stapedius nerve, and the second is the chorda tympani nerve. The chorda tympani nerve supplies it takes the parasympathetic component to the submandibular and sublingual glands, and also the taste sensation of the anterior two thirds of the tongue. Subsequently, the nerve emerges out along with the stylomastoid artery to the stylomastoid foramen, and then it enters into the substance of the parotid gland, and here it separates into the final term, five terminal branches. Now, the way it branches is highly variable. So you have the different types, type 1 to type 6, and these are the most common presentations and how it divides. Now, this is also known as the pes anserinus. Now, why it is important to know that it branches off so much is because whenever there is a small lesion, lesion over here or over here, there are immediate communications taking place. And once this communication takes place, this gives rise to what is known also known as the crocodile tears. Now, apart from this basic understanding, let's move on to how to evaluate and then look at facial palsy itself. Now, in evaluation, always in history, it's important to note the onset and duration of facial palsy, because most of the congenital facial palsies, as we have seen in the anatomy, they will not involve the most of the other parts of the facial components, like the parasympathetic and all is not involved, because mostly in congenital facial palsy, it is the motor component which is involved. That is the reason why even patients who have facial palsy since childhood, they will have very good tear secretion, and also the parasympathetic component is also intact. Now, you should also ask for history of prior injury, either head trauma or regional injury. Head trauma, when it occurs, it can damage the temporal part of the temporal bone itself, wherein the passage as the nerve is passing through it can get damaged. History of facial or ear surgery is important. Now, history of middle ear diseases like otitis media, malignant external otitis or cholesteatoma is important, and associated pain when there is a palsy. The most common causes which give rise to painful facial palsy is Bell's palsy or even herpes zoster in the ear. And if there is hyperacusis, which means that the nervous stapedius has been involved. Now, if there's a decreased taste sensation, it implies that the caudate tympani nerve is involved. We should also look for symptoms of other cranial nerves involvement, like numbness of the face, double vision, anosmia, or difficulty in swallowing. A history of diabetes mellitus is important, because diabetics and even pregnancy is known to, pregnant patients are known to have more higher instances of Bell's palsy. Recent immunization for polio or influenza, and history of any perioral rash around the external ear is an indication of a possible Ramsay-Hunt syndrome. The most common symptoms with which the patient will present is, of course, the inability to close the eye, and irritation, pain around the eye, a chronic red eye. They may also have ectropion and with watering and drooping of the brow. On examination, it's very important to examine the visual acuity first and then look at the face in general. We always look at the facial expression, because the most common facial expression is a masked faces in a bilateral lesion. Unilateral lesion, in a lower motor neuron type of a lesion, the entire hemiface and bits on the side of the lesion loses most of the muscle tone, the most prominent being that the loss of the nasolabial furrow. Always look for the frontalis muscle action, because that will tell us whether the lesion is a supranuclear or a nuclear or infranuclear, and also may give us a plan of action for the patient. Look for the lid closure, whether it is voluntarily passive, and what is the extent of the closure, what is the closure on forced lid closure, and the amount of lag of thalamus. Now, it's very important to document the amount of lag of thalamus by an amount of millimeters, because it will change over time. Also look for upper lid retraction, because during facial palsy, the levator acts unimpeded. That's why the upper lid is retracted upwards. Also examine the tear film, because that gives an indication whether the greater superficial petrosal nerve is involved. We would expect that, yes, the tear film will be much lower if the greater superficial petrosal nerve is involved, because the lacrimal secretion is reduced. But the basal secretion somehow still remains. So even though we may get a lower tear film, most patients will not actually complain of a dry eye. And consequently, also the fifth nerve may also be involved, along with the lesion of the seventh, the facial nerve, in which case the tear film is again further lower. Always look for the lower lid, is presence of ectropion, and we should always look in the slit lamp for any punctal position, because the punctal position may be away from the lacus lacrimalis, and this can again give rise to watering and increased tear film in the affected eye. should always stay in the cornea and look at the corneal status and look for the Bell's phenomenon. Of course, we look at the ocular motility, hearing, we palpate the parotid gland and also palpate the regional lymph nodes. Now, the common causes of facial palsy, it can be congenital. As I mentioned that in congenital facial palsy, it is mostly the motor complex of the neurons of the nerve which is affected. The parasympathetic and even the sensation, the sensory component in the facial nerve is actually spared. And Bell's palsy is actually, what happens is Bell's palsy is one of the diagnoses of exclusion. It is most often confused as facial palsy, but they are two different entities. Facial palsy is a diagnosis where the cause is absolutely known. In spite of investigation and everything, if the cause is not known, it is usually labeled as a Bell's palsy. Bell's palsy, as it is more common in diabetics and during pregnancy. And it is supposed that probably it's because of a viral infection of the structures around the facial nerve cores. But the cause is still not known for the Bell's palsy. Now, it usually recovers in about 3 months' time in about 84% patients. And active intervention is generally not required. We need to usually give supportive treatment. And if it's a diabetic, yes, the blood sugars have to be well under control. All said and done, Bell's palsy is still one of the most common causes of facial palsy. The other causes are the Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, which is also the herpes zoster cephalicus, which is characterized by the presence of nodules and lesions in the external ear and also in the internal ear. And here the nerve is affected in the auditory canal as it is passing through it. The other causes can be the acute otitis media, which can also cause a sixth nerve palsy, wherein you have what's known as the Gradenigo syndrome. Lyme's disease is a fairly a common cause for facial palsy, though not very common in India. It is caused by Borrelia burgdorferi. The other causes is the facial palsy is trauma. As I earlier mentioned, road traffic accidents or injury where the patient falls onto one side of the face, they can actually damage the temporal bone, causing facial palsy. Facial neuromas can also cause facial palsy. Acoustic neuroma usually does not cause facial palsy in the early stages. It's only in the very late stage when the bulk of the tumor is large enough that it compresses on the facial nerve and gives rise to a facial palsy. However, the cause of the treatment for acoustic neuroma, which involves surgery around the CP angle, causes a complete facial palsy. Metastasis around the facial nerve entry into the bony part of its course can also cause a palsy. Infections, this is what we see little more common in India, is leprosy. Leprosy does involve and can also cause bilateral facial palsy, the Guillain-Barré syndrome, and also HIV infections. Now, once knowing the evaluation, we should know to grading systems. There have been a lot of grading systems which have been involved, but the most common one has been the Hauss-Prackmann facial nerve grading system. This was started in the year 1994, it's almost like 26 years back, where they tried to grade the facial nerve palsy and also give some amount of a prognostic feature so that the amount of palsy is classified equally by everybody. But now this grading system has evolved, so we have something called the FNGS2 or the facial nerve grading scale version 2, wherein it has a score of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 for each of these structures analyzed, that is the brow, the eye, the nasolabial fold, and oral features. But what is of importance to us as ophthalmologists is that what happens, some patients, in spite of treatment, they may recover most of their facial functions, like the brow may be down, may be improved, the nasal furrow may improve, oral functions may also improve. Now, as an ophthalmologist, how do we grade it? So there has been a classification which has been given by Dr. Raman Malhotra et al. Now, it's called the CADS grading scale, which takes into consideration the cornea, the staining in the cornea, the asymmetry, that is the static asymmetry, the dynamic function, and the synkinesis. And there have been points which is given to each of them. And this is fairly easy to follow by all ophthalmologists. It's called the CADS grading scale. The importance of grading patients in a CADS grading scale is that when we see them for the first time and how they have improved over time. So most of the Bell's palsy patients will improve on time. It's only those who worsen that they will need some amount of a surgical intervention. Now, regarding the management, there are some general considerations which we have to consider. One is the age of the patient. Generally, younger patients will be able to tolerate the insult of the facial nerve palsy because they will have a much better tear film. Their ability to tolerate the insults, the corneal insult which is there, is much better than elderly patients. Elderly patients, the ability to tolerate an exposed eye is much less, and they have a higher risk of developing corneal exposure keratopathy. Occupation, it's important because people who are working on long time on laptops, software engineers, those who work in hot environments, hot and dry environment like cooks, those working in very close to furnaces, they will have higher chances of having dryness and their complications related to it. And of course, the ability to comply to treatment. The other considerations is the risk of exposure and corneal ulceration, and whether the sensations are present or not in the cornea. Patients who do not have corneal sensations, the cornea tends to deteriorate much faster than those who actually have an intact corneal sensation. Severe lag of thalamus will require an early surgical intervention and also the absence of Bell's phenomenon. And same is the situation with patients with dry eyes. And also, of course, it gives a clue as to where the lesion has been. Now, the medical treatment is with the topical preservative-free lubricants. The amount of lubricants to be applied depends on the degree of the facial nerve palsy or the Bell's palsy and the amount of exposure which is there. Topical gels at bedtime. There's something called the moisture chamber. There's something called moisture chamber goggles, wherein the goggles have a small chamber within them where you can put a pledget of moist cotton. So what this does is as the day progresses and the patient is wearing it, with the heat that is generated inside, the water, the moisture tends to stay within the chamber, within the glasses, and the incidence of dry eye is reduced. Alternately, what we also do in our practice is we use something called a cellophane tape, cellophane moisture chamber. That is, we take a sheet of cellophane paper and we cut it to the contour of the eye and we tape it across onto the brow and the cheeks with a micropore or tape, sticking tape. This is very cheap. It hardly costs anything to the patient. The advantage that it provides is that it gives the same advantages as that of a moisture chamber, and it hardly costs the patient anything. Of course, moisture chamber goggles are available online, though not very easily available in our country. Now, taping of the lids has been practiced and has been advised in many centers. Now, the problem with taping of the lids is that if it's not done correctly, what happens is the eye tends to open under the tape, and the corneal erosions tend to worsen. Because as the patient is sleeping in deep sleep, if the tape loosens up, especially from the upper lid, that's when the eye opens up and the cornea is stuck onto the sticky part of the tape. So when the patient actually gets up in the morning, he's much more worser than he slept with it. So taping of the lids is not something that I usually advise. I tell patients to put on a cellophane moisture chamber. They're much more comfortable with it. Injection botulinum toxin is given, can be given into the levator palpebis superioris. It takes about 4 days to act. And what it does is that it induces ptosis, hence it protects the eye and also reduces the amount of damage to the cornea from that of thymus. The only fallback is that it can also paralyze the superior rectus muscle. But since the eye is going to be completely closed, patients will not experience much of a double vision or diplopia. Role of corticosteroids. Earlier, all patients of Bell's palsy, when they're confirmed to have diagnosis of Bell's palsy, were put on oral steroids in the assumption that the viral infection will have caused some amount of edema around the facial nerve. But now it has been proven that there is no role of corticosteroids, and it does not actually benefit the patient in any way. Now, coming to the surgical treatment of facial palsy, can be graded as four ways. One is the prevention or management of corneal exposure. The second could be the correction of lower lid ectropion. Third is the management of the brow ptosis. Fourth would be the management of chronic epiphora. Now, management of corneal exposure, the simplest and perhaps the easiest to do is a temporary suture tarsography. This can be done in the OPD itself, where we take a silk suture through the gray line, through the gray line of both the lids, and a suture is tied. This temporary suture tarsography will stay for about a week, 10 days, and then it tends to open up because the force of opening is much more stronger than the force of closure that we put with a temporary suture. The other option is to do a lateral tarsography. Now, the reason of doing a lateral tarsography is that it decreases the palpebral aperture such that the corneal exposure is reduced. Now, there are a lot of opinions on lateral tarsography. Nowadays, many of them even do a lateral tarsal strip with a much higher positioning of the lateral canthus. This also gives a result very similar to that of a lateral tarsography. Now, I'll just show a video of a tarsography called the tongue in groove tarsography. There are a lot of different ways of doing a tarsography. You have the intermarginal type of a tarsography. You have the something called the pillar type of a tarsography. What I'm showing here is something called as the tongue in groove tarsography, where after taking gray line incision in the upper lid, of the desired amount of the closure that we want, both the lamella are split, the anterior and posterior lamella, and the tongue is fashioned from the upper lid. Now, similar to that, in the lower lid, we fashion another tongue of the same dimension, but in this, what is done is, instead of keeping the tongue as it is, I would be excising the tongue in the lower lid away. Now, if you join both these two posterior lamella, it would become the pillar type of a tarsography. Now, the tongue is sutured into the groove with an absorbable suture. Here I'm using a 6-0 vitrel. I usually take a mattress suture and where it is anchored onto the groove. And once that is done, we see the amount of closure which is attained by the tarsography itself. Now, here I'm doing a little paramedian lateral tarsography. And once two bites are taken, the anterior lamella is closed over a bolster. Tarsographies can be done anyway. There are a lot of people who just do an intermarginal tarsography, and that's also equally successful. I find that this technique is much more longer lasting and it has a much more stronger attachment than an intermarginal suture. There's also a technique by which we can anchor the medial part of the lid, because sometimes the medial lag is much more than the lateral lag, in which case we can do a medial canthoplasty where the eyelids medial to the puncta are fused. And this also helps to prevent the development of a medial lower lid ectropion. Now, we can combine a lateral tarsography or a lateral tarsal strip along with a medial canthoplasty. Another technique in which we can bring down the upper lid is the molarectomy or and an LPS recession. There are various ways again of doing the LPS recession, both from the conjunctival aspect as well as from the skin aspect. I don't have much experience of doing from the conjunctival aspect, but I prefer to do it from the skin aspect. Now, I just don't do a recession because in which cases, once you do a recession and leave the muscle much higher, it can go and get attached anywhere. So I prefer to use something like a spacer graft. I prefer to use a squirrel patch graft so that I know exactly how much amount of recession I would want. Here, this patient is having actually a chronic exposure where the lower lid is fairly in position, but it's only the upper lid which was more at fault. The lag was much more in because of the upper lid lag. So we did a skin approach to expose the levator palpebrae and then used a did a recession and used a little spacer graft for the amount of recession which I was wanting. So I just forward this video so that now this is the amount of recession once the recession has been that's the amount of recession that would attain so that the patient's lid will tend to lie just above the just below the superior limbus. Now the amount of recession is calculated and an equal amount of scleral patch graft is taken. This is a donor sclera. And once it is sized, it is sutured onto both the ends, the one end to the levator palpebrae superioris and the other end to the upper border of the tarsus. And again, as we are suturing it up, we check that the amount of fall of the levator, is it good enough? And then the lip sutures are taken and the surgery is closed. So here's at the end of surgery, we can see that the lid is fallen down quite well, and this should actually suffice. The other technique of bringing down the upper lid is also the upper lid gold weight implant. Now, this is a patient who's had a acoustic neuroma removal in the right eye. In spite of having a lateral tarsorrhaphy and a lateral tarsal strip, she still has a significant amount of lag of thalamus. And actually, she also had significant corneal changes because of corneal anesthesia. So we wanted to actually get a much better closure of the upper lid. So we chose her for a gold weight implant. Now, the approach is very similar. We need to take a lip crease incision. And once a lip crease incision is taken, we need to make a suborbicularis pocket and then place the implant. Now, the gold implant which is used, it's very important that it has to be a pure 24 karat gold implant. It is of 0.999 purity. Now, there is a company which makes it. It's commercially available by MedDev. But what happens is this implant is a little more expensive. So what we have done is we have a tie-up with my goldsmith who gives a guarantee of giving us a pure 24 karat gold of 0.99 purity. We have given our design to him and he's fashioned the gold weight for us. This is autoclaved and stored and it is used. Now, the importance, I tend to put the gold implant by switching it onto the lower edge onto the, as far as possible, lower down onto the tarsal plate. And the higher one tends to be just above the higher end, the superior edge of the tarsal plate. This is, of course, under a suborbicularis dissection. Now, the importance of doing this surgery is that we should use preferably non-absorbable sutures as we try to anchor. Here, I'm using a polyester suture to anchor the gold implant. once the implant is put in place, the lid incision is closed in layers, that is, the muscle is closed. Importance is that the muscle should be closed very well, preferably with a non-absorbable suture, and then the skin is closed with a either an absorbable or non-absorbable continuous suture. Now, this is how the patient looked just after 1 week of the surgery. She has got a good acceptance of the gold implant. Now, gold implant again has its own set of problems. There are some patients who cannot, who will still have extrusion of the implant. In spite of having extrusion, what we have seen is that there is generally a small capsule which forms around the gold implant after some time. Even though the gold is supposed to be inert, there's a small capsule which forms around the implant. In cases of extrusion, somehow the amount of fibrous reaction, the fibrous tissue, and the scarring which happens in the suborbitalis plane tends to somehow close the lid in spite of the extrusion of the implant. So in a few, in our practice, we've had close to about 30% of patients who've had extrusion. In spite of that, most of the patients had no corneal exposure post removal of the extruded gold implant. There are also other ways of taking care of corneal exposure. One is the silicone rod encerclage, also known as Arion's silicone rod, wherein a silicone rod is passed all around the upper and the lower lids, and that is tightened. And the other is the palpebral spring, which is applied, which is supported onto the orbital rim on one side and onto the tarsal plate, the lower end, and also the temporalis muscle transfer. I have no personal experience with the palpebral spring or the temporalis muscle transfer, but what literature says is that it is not without its own set of complications, and of all of them, still the upper lid gold weight implant is still one of the better options. Now, coming to the management of the lower lid ectropion can be a problem because it not only gives rise to watering, but as the patient stays with the facial palsy for a much longer period of time, gravity pulls everything down. So as the patient is mobile, the face is lax, the lower lid is also pulled down, so ectropion becomes a problem. Now, the various ways of correcting lower lid ectropion is, of course, by the lateral tarsal strip, which will pull it up. We can also do something called the medial tarsal strip. Now, the only sacrifice when we do a medial tarsal strip is that the patient will still have tearing because the canthal system is excised when we create a medial tarsal strip. There has been a lot of recent interest in a technique which is now known as the posterior medial canthal tendon thermoplasty. Now, what is done here is that a row of burns or with a cautery is given just medial to the punctum. So we put a probe in the punctum, in the lower lid, and then just on the conjunctival aspect, we give about two or three rows of cautery burns, right up to, almost up to the carancle. The idea is that the muscle, the hornous muscle, is actually burnt, and this causes a pull, medial pull on the muscle, and this actually takes it inward, takes the entire punctum and the medial part of it inwards. Now, this posterior medial canthal tendon thermoplasty can be done in isolation, or it can also be done in along with the lateral tarsal strip. Now, this is a patient, if you notice, she's had a palsy in the, she has a palsy in the left eye. Now, see the position of the lower lid. The lower lid is much lower than that of the upper lid, of the other side. That is the reason why the lid is not closing. Of course, there is also a lag of thalamus because the upper lid is also not falling down. So in this case, there are two options. One is to correct the upper lid and let it fall down. You can use a gold weight implant. The other option is to pick up the lower lid. Now, the problem with gold weight implant is, of course, it is expensive for some patients, and still it is an implant where you want to introduce something. So the other option is to pick up the lower lid. So this patient underwent a medial tarsal strip and a lateral tarsal strip with a medial canthal tendon thermoplasty. Now, this is the immediate postoperative at a week's time. We can see that the lid has actually gone up. This is the position of the right side. This is the position in the left side. This is actually gone up. This can, of course, be combined with a gold weight implant later on for the remaining amount of a lack of thalamus. Now, there is also another way where we can actually strengthen the posterior lamella of the lower lid by when we are doing a lateral tarsal strip and a medial tarsal strip, we can also increase the height of the tarsus by putting a scleral patch graft. The management of brow ptosis, there are different ways of doing the same, either do a direct brow lift or an endoscopic brow lift. Now, whenever we're doing a brow ptosis, it's important to understand that the brow, when it falls down in a long-standing case of a facial palsy, actually helps in pulling the lower lid down because of the weight that it possesses. So we should not jump and do a brow ptosis correction the moment we see it. In a long-standing case where the lag of thalamus is fairly okay and the correction is fairly, the cornea is not too exposed, in those cases, we can always go with the brow ptosis correction. Aberrant degeneration of facial nerve can be a problem. Now, that can give rise to what is known as the crocodile tears. That's because, as we discussed, that the pes and serenus, as the nerve is entering into the parotid gland, there are various ways in which it can divide. And because it divides into so many branches within the gland, any lesion, there will be an aberrant degeneration that gives rise to crocodile tears. The other is the Marien-Amart syndrome, wherein some of the fibers which supply the buccinator muscle actually can go and supply back into the lacrimal gland. So whenever the patient is talking or blowing his cheek or even eating, that time the patient can have tearing. Now, in these cases where there is excessive amount of tearing, botulinum toxin into the lacrimal gland can give some amount of relief. I usually tend to give about 2.5 units of Botox into the lacrimal gland. How long does it act? It acts to about 3 months to maximum about 4 months, by which time again the patients may require another roll of Botox into the lacrimal gland. Now, in patients who've had a facial nerve injury, along with the fifth nerve, that is the trigeminal nerve, is also involved, and the corneal anesthesia is very severe, they may actually benefit with a corneal neurotization surgery. There's also a lot of interest now, and most of the surgeons are also shifting to what is also called the facial neurotization, wherein they use either the donor graft, where a sural nerve is transplanted, or you also get allografts. You get free peripheral nerves as donor from a donor, which is available, and they are also used to do a neurotization. In facial neurotization, you have a nerve which is connected from the opposite side facial nerve. It can go across from the brow. So that is how most of the tearing problem can also be solved. That's about it. I think I've covered most of it, and I'm sure there'll be a lot of many other things. There'll be many various techniques of solving the facial nerve problems on the face. But what I have enlisted for you is what I've been practicing and what I've also gathered from most of my colleagues. Thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, Dr. Saptagirish.
If anybody has questions, I'll be willing to take them here. Dr. Rahul is asking, is there any chance of recurrence of Bell's palsy? Yes, Bell's palsy, please understand that Bell's palsy is a diagnosis of exclusion. Now, it occurs because of an edema, which occurs as the facial nerve is exiting from the sternomastoid foramen. So yes, it can recur. And whenever it recurs, the patient is going to have the same problems of an ipsilateral facial nerve palsy. Recurrence is most common in diabetics, and that's when the edema happens. Dr. Devakani is asking, is gold plate surgery reversible? Reversible, yes, it is. We can always remove the gold plate. Now, in cases, in patients who've had acute palsy, there are various ways again of using the gold plate. Now, we also get matching silver plates because they're much more cheaper. And even if you lose them, it's not much of a cost. You also get something called skin colored plates, which the patient can actually apply onto the upper lid. And they can be removed as the patient improves. Now, even a gold weight implant, once if the patient's function is very, very good, then there's always the option of removing it, take it out. As I had mentioned, once you remove a gold weight, gold implant from inside, there's a small capsule which forms around it that can actually bring down the lid further. You also have other implants. You also have platinum implants, which of course I have had no experience in using. Dr. Sri Ramcharan is asking, can we use other materials as an alternative to gold? Yes, we can use platinum. Other materials, you cannot use silver or other materials because they can react with the tissues. We need to use an inert material. So a good inert material is gold and platinum. Now, you can also use titanium, but titanium is too light. Or to get the amount of weight that you want the lid to fall down, a titanium mesh or a titanium implant would have to be much thicker. So that's why we cannot use titanium. So the best option remains either with gold or with platinum. Dr. Swati Sahu is asking, can you demonstrate correct method of taping of lid? Well, taping of lid itself is a very bad thing to do because the patient's eyes can move, can open up during sleep. But also that done, if you still want to be adamant about taping the lid, you have to have someone close the eye, to ask the patient to close both the eyes. The affected eye will still not close, so they have to hold the lashes and pull it down. And then the tape is applied to the upper lid and the upper lid, and then the lower part is applied onto the cheek. So that is the problem, because when the patient is sleeping, if there's sweat or oil on the face, it will open up. Dr. Dharani Joshi is asking, role of galvanic stimulation. Yes, that is being done for facial palsies, and the main idea is that you stimulate the facial nerve and keep the muscle tone intact. So we don't do galvanic stimulation in our hospital, but yes, it is done by physiotherapists, and also they do the facial massage exercises to maintain the muscle tone. Preeti Shetty is asking, do gold weights work in supine position? No, they will not work. It works by gravity. So when the patient is lying down, or when the patient is sleeping, you should instruct them to use a pillow or put the head in elevated. Because if they're lying down flat, there's a chance that the gold weight may work the other way around, in which case the exposure is going to get worse. So whenever a patient undergoes a gold weight surgery, it is important to tell the patients to sleep with the head and little elevated. Dr. Sameeksha is asking, could you elaborate on the procedure of LPS Botox for levothermis? Botulinum toxin is to be given to the levator palpebrae superioris. So use a much longer needle. We tend to use a 26 half inch needle for most of our Botox injections, or a 30 gauge half inch needle. But when you want to give it for to the LPS, you have to go actually into the orbit. You can enter, of course, with a 26 gauge half inch needle, but better to use a 1 inch needle. So you enter just the way as you would go for a frontalis nerve block, but before injecting, just tip it towards the globe and then inject about 2.5 units into the LPS. Yes, problem of giving into the LPS at that position is that it is in very close proximity to the superrectus muscle. So that can also get affected by the Botox or the botulinum toxin. So patient can also have a superrectus palsy, induced superrectus palsy or paresis. Dr. Yash is asking, would you prefer doing tarsography with bolsters or without it, and any specific conditions where you would bolsters specifically? Yes, tarsography putting a bolster is basically to anchor the anterior lamella, so that when you tighten the anterior lamella, it does not give away very easily. That's why you want to use a bolster. Now, bolster is better to be used because you're going to tie the anterior lamella with a fair amount of tightness. The moment the patient's anesthesia is worn off, the patient is going to open the eyes voluntarily, as well as because the facial palsy is there, the eye will tend to open up. So it's preferable to use bolsters. Of late, yes, I've also done surgeries without using bolsters and found not much of a difference. Dr. Shruti is asking, what is your opinion on imaging the patients? Is it required in all? If not, how do we choose? Most patients with Bell's palsy, it is not required. Bell's palsy is a diagnosis, of course, of exclusion. Now, patients in whom I definitely find more of a central type of a lesion, or is of course a supranuclear lesion, or in those patients who have other symptoms of where the facial nerve could have been involved, like taste, hearing, you find a cephalic herpes zoster, that is Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, or any other cranial nerve things is involved, elderly patients who are non-diabetic, it's better to image them. And when doing an imaging, it's better to do an MRI so that we will know what is there. Now, all said and done, all patients with hemifacial spasm, I do an MRI with a contrast, with a specific note to the radiologist to look for the CP angle area. And mentioning that, I'm looking at an ICA aneurysm or ICA abnormality. Now, only when we specify the radiologist will look at those areas. The reason being that hemifacial spasm, most of them actually have some amount of a small anterior inferocerebral artery aneurysm which is pressing onto it. Of course, there are various grades of that same. You have the Chowdhury's classification of grade 1, 2, and 3, and the Lagella's classification of up to 4. Dr. Vijay Bhaskar Reddy is asking, other than gold plate, is there any material? I think I've just answered. You can use platinum. Dr. Vidyarthi Divakaran is asking, can you please explain mechanism of neurotization? Yes, of course. I think we'll be going much beyond the scope of this session, but the mechanism of the idea of neurotization is that you think it very broadly, like it's a wire, you know. One wire is not functioning because there is no current passing through it. And you have another wire which is running close to it with current passing through it, and you try to make a connection from the connecting the two. It's as raw as that, but that is the idea how it is done. Now, of course, there are a lot of other things involved in it. It has been seen that once you established a neuronal pathway, even if it is not functioning as the same way as it was earlier, the amount of impulses, the tissues tends to respond much better. Riddhi Arya is asking, can you please explain how to make a cellophane moisture chamber? Yes, actually a cellophane moisture chamber is one of the simplest to make. What we do is you get cellophane paper, the one that is used to cover books and all that. It's also known as onion paper. It's available in all stationery stores. You need to cut the cellophane paper according to the size of the orbit of the patient, orbital opening. That is from the above the brow, above the eyebrow and below the lower lid here to this shape. And then it is stuck onto the face with some micropore or transport, and that's how it works. And patient can use it before going to sleep. They just have to just put some tear surface lubricants and then use the cellophane moisture chamber. It works very well. Dr. Devanshu has a question. He says, what is a cheaper option for gold plate and how about spiral patch graft? Yes, there is no cheaper option for gold plate. You can't use silver. And of course, there are expensive options for gold. You can use platinum. And of course, whenever you're using gold, ensure that you have the person who's making it, because they have to give a guarantee that it is pure 24 karat gold of 0.999 purity at least. And using a little patch graft, yes, you can use. I had just shown that you can do an LPS resection and use a little patch graft in the upper lip. That can also be a good option. Dr. Poonam Jain is asking, in long-standing facial palsy, do you give botulinum toxin to improve the symmetry? The main concern in actually facial palsy is functional. It's not so much of a cosmetic issue. But yes, in patients who have actually recovered most of the functions, we can still give botulinum toxin to improve the symmetry. It can be done, yes. I have no experience in that, but it can be done. Dr. Jayashree Shah is asking, what is the cost and weight of the gold implants? I'll ask the second part. The weight, it can, you can fashion it from 0.8 grams. Come in 0.2 steps, that is 0.8, 1 gram, 1.2, 1.4, 1.6, right up to 2 grams. And how do you titrate the amount of gold implant that is to be applied? Is by using a similar weight of a silver implant. So when the patient comes to the OPD, you use a similar type of a, you use a silver implant and tape it onto the, with a thin amount of micropore, you stick it onto the upper lid of the patient. And you can ask the patient to maybe wait outside. And then you see the amount of closure that the patient is having and how comfortable they are with the silver implant. Once the patient is comfortable, then you know the amount of gold, the weight of the gold implant that you're going to apply. Now, the reason why you don't put gold and ask the patient to wait outside is very obvious, because the patient can just walk out with the gold implant that you put. And regarding the cost, well, it depends. We get it much cheaper with our goldsmith here, who gives the cost at cost price of whatever the cost of the gold that he has put. For him, it's like a CSR project. So he just gives it at the cost of whatever the cost of the gold that he has put. There are others who, MedDev and all is pretty expensive, and it's a little difficult for us getting it here. So I don't use MedDev per se. Dr. Devakani is asking, will there be rejection with donor sclera? What are the signs that patients should be aware of? I have not seen any rejection with the donor sclera. But yes, donor sclera in the lid ultimately undergoes fibrotic replacement. That is, it is replaced by fibrous tissue in long run. That's what will happen. And I have not seen any rejection of the donor sclera as of yet. And what are the signs patients should be aware of? Patient actually will not notice any donor sclera rejection because it's quite deep inside. And there can be rejection signs when the patient is using the gold weight implant, wherein it will start thinning out and it will start getting more exposed. Dr. Shubha Raghuram is asking, does posterior medial canthal tendon thermoplasty in any way reduce the non-aberrant tearing to a certain extent? No, Dr. Shubha, the posterior MCT thermoplasty will not reduce the non-aberrant tearing. It is just that it will anchor the lid in a much more better way. Now, in patients who do not have a facial palsy, but have actually a median ectopia, in them, of course, the tearing will reduce because the lid is now much better opposed. But in a patient who is having facial palsy, and in them you do a MCT thermoplasty, the non-aberrant tearing will still persist. Preeti is asking that a pulsation of the anterior inferior cerebral artery, not through aneurysm, may be responsible for hemifacial spasm. Then how will you explain middle or late onset of hemifacial spasm? Dr. Preeti, it depends upon the contact between the anterior inferior cerebral artery and the facial nerve. Now, there are a lot of grades of how it has been involved. Sometimes you can even have an anterior, the ICA, that is the anterior inferior cerebral artery, which enters into the internal acoustic meatus too. Now, depending on how far it is extended, the amount of spasm may vary. Now, all patients who have a contact will not actually have a hemifacial spasm because it depends on the compression on the sheath. So those who have very significant contact, it will be them who will be having a hemifacial spasm. That is why in these patients, when you put a Teflon sheet or Teflon sponge between the nerve and the artery, they improve immediately. Dr. Shweta has a question. She's asking, patient presenting with hemifacial spasm post facial palsy with mild lag of thalamus and lower diptropion, should we consider Botox for hemifacial spasm in such patients? Yes, of course, you can also give Botox for hemifacial spasm. It's a proven modality of treatment. Not all patients of hemifacial spasm will need a surgery because surgery has its own morbidity. Botox is a very safe option. In temporary tarsography, do we pass suture through center or identify which part is having maximum dead lag? This is a question by Dr. Preeti. Yes, we pass the suture through the gray line, and depending on which part will give you maximum closure, it does not always have to be lateral. It can be paramedian medial or paramedian lateral. As long as you're able to cover the corneal exposure, that is where you're going to pass your suture. Dr. Akshay is asking, maximum time one can wait to switch from conservative to definitive management for patient palsy. Well, it depends upon a diagnosis. If you know that the patient is going to be non-compliant, has had a pure facial palsy, not a Bell's palsy, and has had a tumor removal, let us say acoustic neuroma removal, these patients are never going to improve. So maybe you can give an initial conservative treatment just for to buy some time, but patients will definitely need definitive treatment. Now, patients who are having pure Bell's palsy, let's say a diabetic with high blood sugars has developed a Bell's palsy, they can be initially managed with conservative treatment because they may have complete recovery of the facial nerve palsy itself. Dr. Preeti is asking, what is the dose of Botox in LPS? I usually tend to give about 2.5 to 5 units. Pooja, how do you manage patients with crocodile tears? Well, it's very difficult. The simplest is, of course, to give botulinum toxin into the lacrimal gland. I tend to give about 2.5 units into the lacrimal gland. They tend to do a little better. Of course, not all patients with Botox into the lacrimal gland are going to improve, but there's also a subset of patients who will improve. Dr. Vandana is asking, what is the lowest age limit for botulinum toxin injection? Well, there is nothing like a lowest age for Botox. For cosmetic, yes. But for functional reason, we can give it anytime. Of course, even for functional, even for cosmetic, there have been a lot of cosmetic oculoplastic surgeons who have been even in younger patients, even less than about 18 years of age. Does PES and serenus explain why every patient of facial palsy does not develop crocodile tears? Absolutely. Dr. Preeti Jain, that's absolutely right. Not every patient of facial palsy will develop crocodile tears, and the converse also. Why patients can also have crocodile tears is because of the very dense anastomosis which happens in the parotid gland as the nerve appears from the parotid gland. Any other questions? No, I don't see any other questions. I think I'll just take this last question. In extrusion of gold implant comes out or dislodges from the suborbital plane. What are the symptoms and signs of extrusion? Well, the symptoms, patients will definitely come and say that the gold is visible. And when you examine the patient, you can see that the gold has come out of the skin. And it does dislodge from the suborbitalis to the skin, it tends to come out. It can also, of course, erode onto the tarsal plate also. But most commonly, since the tarsus is much more thicker and stronger, it tends to come out from the to the orbicularis and the skin. I think that's all for now. Thank you all for a very patient listening. Tomorrow's session is going to be on accommodation and convergence and its abnormalities and how to correct them by Dr. Kavita, who is a consultant at consultant pediatric ophthalmologist at Shimoga. The link remains the same and the time remains the same, 12 o'clock to 1 p.m. Thank you all. Take care and stay safe.